Hey Adam, the section online, does that have my amendment in it on patience? No, does that have that amendment I put in 3 a.m. in the morning? Remember we were voting? Is that, yes, it is the way it is.
Okay, okay. I'd like to ask a question.
Wait a minute, Adam, that's not correct. Oh, sorry. Adam, I don't think my amendment is illustrated on the online version.
It's not illustrated on the online
version. It's not. It's slightly different, but on the whole, it's generally the amendments I had. Amendment in to make sure that the ombudsman had to work with the patient with representatives on issues that patient people are bringing up to the ombudsman. Because I wanted to make sure that the patient had a voice in what was going on.
Okay.
That's the only part that I think is represented.
Since you've got your vote there with you with the bill, maybe we could refer to the same section. I'm referring to section 123, paragraph 3, that has to do with the membership of that advisory committee. I beg your pardon?
It has to do with what?
It has to do with the membership of the advisory committee. According to the House Bill 3200, the membership of the committee, two-thirds of that membership is appointed by the president, and the remaining one-third is appointed by the Comptroller General, who is appointed by the president. So in essence, 100% of the Health Care Advisory Committee, which is the committee that is going to be establishing the terms of our benefit plan, are appointed directly by the president. And this is a two-point question. If 100% of all those members are appointed by one person, in essence, what are we doing with bipartisanship? And what are we doing with bias and having unbiased voters? Shall participate in a panel of what it sounds like to be 27 people. So of 27 people, you have one physician or one healthcare professional making decisions about our healthcare. Explain that, please, to this
group. Yes. That's not for us to talk about. And I'm happy to go through the bill.
Yeah. Well, please respond to my first question about the president appointing.
Absolutely, I will. But the second part is not. The first part is part of the reason, and actually it's a very good point, we might even want to relook at this, but part of the reason why I had another amendment in there that mandated that the patient representative had to be, couldn't just be picked out of the blue, it had to be somebody who comes from a professional background within a patient advocacy group. But I do think she has a point here. Potentially, I do know how the bill reads, but potentially I haven't followed through enough because when I think about the NLRB, National Labor Relations Board, which is appointed by the president, and how that has kind of swung from one side to the other side over which president tends to appoint it, it's actually something to take back from this town hall. I think it's a very good point, man. I did. You know, the president, but I mean, we'll have to figure out a way and propose a way that things are more fair, might be more fair. We always have a problem with who appoints. You know, you get it from the NLRB, you get it from the Federal Reserve, you get it from here. And you're right, this is where you want principle to triumph over politics. And it's a very good point. It's a very good point. I have to think of a way to make sure it's more fair, you know what I mean, to make sure you don't tilt it a different way. But Adam, I think we'll take that one back, okay?